thinking. I said, preaching does something to me because, you know, I think about, if anybody knows, you know, I'm not really good at getting up early. You know, I'm not really good at being able to get up early and do, but, you know, I told Mom, I said, I got up at 6:30 this morning. And I said, that's not like me. You know, to get up in there, I went in there, I started watching Andy Griffith with Uncle Russell. You know, that's not like me. I don't get up early. I'm the type of person that wants to sleep in until about 3 o'clock. But, you know, that's something. That's something how God does something to me. You know, he gets, he puts an excitement in my life, you know, to be able to get up here and preach the words that he gave me to preach. You know, I was thinking about 8 minutes Sunday school lesson, you know. I'm glad that I was raised in a church, you know, where I know that you, Uncle Russell said to me many times, if you want to be somewhere, you'll get up an hour or so early. You know, I'm glad it's good to be in the house this morning. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. You know, we don't got as many people as we usually do, but I believe God can still come, you know, he can still move.
And yes, amen.
No way. I want to start off reading in the book of Job and saying, then whenever you get there, Job chapter 1, y'all have to stand because I got a lot of reading to do. Job chapter 1 and verse 1, it says, there was a man in the name of Uz whose name was Job, and that was perfect, upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. His substance was also known, 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels, and 500 young oxen and 500 she asses, and a very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the east. And his sons went and feasted in their houses, every one his day, and sent and called their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. And it was so. The days of their feasting were going about, that Job sent and sanctified them, and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. The Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking it up and down. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, as there is none like him in the earth, perfect and upright man, one that feared God and escheweth evil? I'm going to stop there for just a second. You know, it talks about Job. It says that he was a man that was perfect and upright. It says that he was one that feared God and escheweth evil. You know, Job was a perfect man. You know, he did no wrong or whatever, but, you know, it says that he eschewed evil. You know, he didn't only need, he feared God. You know, he knew who his Savior was. He knew who was over him. You know, he feared him. And I thought about right there, it says that, have you considered my servant Job? You know, as I begin to think and I begin to get this message, I decided to title it, Press On. You know, we all know the story of Job. I don't want to get ahead of myself. I'm going to keep on reading here in just a few minutes. But we all know the story of Job. We all know what he went through. We all know what he faced. You know, I thought about, you know, what if the Lord was able to call on you and say, devil, why don't you go tempt my servant Mason? You know, why don't you go tempt my servant Anna, Hank, Lena, Fudge, you know, all Granny, you know? What if you was to go and tempt one of them, you know, would you be able to stand, would you be able to stand firm whenever the devil, you know, the Lord is able to send the devil after you? You know, he believes in you so much that you're not going to sin, that he puts so much faith in you that he's able to send the devil to come and attack you, you know, to be able to come and just, it says, the devil's out to seek, to kill and devour. You know, he wants to devour, you know, he wants to take over, you know. There's something, you know, that God saw Job fit, that he could send the devil, you know, to torment him, to torture him. But you know what? It says Job did not sin. You know, he sinned not after all that he does. I want to keep on reading here. And it says, then Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for not? Has thou not made a hedge about him and about his house, and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and the substance is increased in the land. But put forth thy hand now and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power, only upon him, not put forth thy hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. Now right there, it told him, he said, you can touch everything that he's got. You know, you can touch all his cattle, you know, all his family. But you know what? Don't put your hand upon him. And it says, the devil told him, he said, that if you... He said, put forth thy hand now and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. You know, the devil thought, if I could take and I could do this to Job, you know, he would curse God. But God told him, he said, you can do all that you want to his cattle, to his family, you know, to anything that he touched and all that he hath. But don't put no hand upon Job, you know, spare his life, keep him. But keep on reading. It says, the Lord has said to Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power, only upon himself put not forth thy hand. Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord, and there was a day when his sons and his daughters were eating and drinking wine, and the elders fled his houses, and there came a messenger to Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the asses feeding beside him. And the Sabines fell upon them, and they took them away. They have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only escaped alone to kill thee. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the fire of God has fallen from heaven and hath burned up the sheep, and the servants consumed them, and I only escaped alone to kill thee. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the Chaldeans made out three bands and fell upon the camels and carried them away. Ye have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I escaped alone to tell thee. And while he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. And behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the four corners of his house, and fell upon the young men, and they are dead, and I only am escaped to tell thee. Then Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshipped and said, naked I came out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. With all this, Job sinned not, but their charge got foolishly. You know, I want to stop there for a few minutes. I'm going to go on in a few minutes and read chapter 2. But, you know, right here it talks about Job lost all his cattle, you know. He lost all his sheep, all his she-asses, all his oxen. You know, he lost every bit of cattle that he had. And yet still, Job did not sin not. You know, I thought about the house. He says that he took and smote all four corners of the house and killed all his sons and all his daughters, you know. And yet still, he sinned not, you know. I thought about what if we put ourselves in Job's shoes, you know. What if he took me? What if he took Eddie, you know? Aunt Lynn. What if he took Uncle Buddy from you? You know, what if he took your children, all your animals, you know, whatever you own, what if he took that? Would you sin against him? You know, would you curse his face? You know, oftentimes we try to blame God for stuff that happened.
Come on, man.
So all we gotta do is trust in God.
That's right.
And I'm like, wow, God, why? You know, but that's not for me to understand, that's for him to understand.
Yes,
you know?
Come on.
I'm supposed to be the one putting my faith in him. You know, what would we do if we put ourselves in Job's shoes? You know, will we sin not, or will we give in? You know, will we let the devil devour us? What would we do if we put ourselves in Job's shoes?
That's right.
You know, it said Job had 7 sons and 3 daughters, said he considered them all his blessings. You know, I was reading the commentary or whatever, as Aunt Lynn was talking about, you know, it said you should consider your children as blessings. You know, it's something that God blesses you to be able to have, you know. And something, you know, being able to have a kid, you know, being a dad, being a mom, whatever it is, you know, that's a blessing that God put upon your life. But it said Job had 7 sons and 3 daughters. It says he had many cattle, 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels, and 500 yoke of oxen and 500 she-asses. He was the greatest of all the men of the East, you know. It says there in the study Bible, it says that he was the greatest man of all the East, you know. Out of all the cattle that he had, you know, he was the greatest. He had the most, you know. I thought about Mr. Glenn, you know, he's got all them cows, you know. What would he do if he lost all of them, you know? I remember as we go over there to his house and he'd have all them cows and stuff running around, you know. What if he would have lost all that, you know? When we sin against God, we lost all that we had. If we were the greatest man in the East and we lost that role, you know, would you still sin or would you keep on going? You know, would you keep pressing on? We'll start reading chapter 2. It says, again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord. The Lord said unto Satan, from whence comest thou? And Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth and from walking it up and down. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job? There is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil, and he still holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without cause. Now right there, in verse 3, it says, Job, there is none like him, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God, and still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without cause. You know, whenever the devil took all his cattle, you know, he tried to blame God. He tried to make it look like, you know, God was the one that did this, because in the study Bible it said that his sheep, you know, that's what he used for burnt offerings, because it was talking about him going up and, you know, praying for his kids. You know, I thought about it. Sister Charlotte was talking a while ago, you know, talking about praying or whatever. You know, Job, he woke up early in the morning and went and prayed for the sins that his son committed. You know, I mean, he's getting up there and talking about the sheep that he gave for a burnt offering, you know. The devil made it look like that God took that sheep away from him, like he was mad at the burnt offering. You know, that's what it says in the study Bible. And I was thinking, you know, he took that away from him to make it think that God had turned against him, you know, to make him curse
Come
his
on,
name.
That's right.
But yet, still, the whole time it was the devil, but he's still trying to manipulate him, he's still trying to
get
his
right.
mind. He's
Come
trying
on,
to give him that, that God had took all that from him, that God had did all that to him. But it says that yet still, he still held fast his integrity, although that moves me against him. You know, Job still was standing firm, you know.
That's
whatever it talks about right here, the devil is again, he's looking to destroy somebody, he's looking to devour somebody,
That's
yet
right.
still
Job is still steadfast. He's still staying firm. He's still pressing on. You know, that's all you gotta do. Whenever times get tough, I know that it may be hard. It may seem like you can't go nowhere else. But I'm telling you, press on. I'm telling you, press on. Stay fast. Don't give up. That'll be your worst mistake, is to give up.
That's right.
Yes. Says the same answer to the Lord. It says, skin for skin, ye all that man hath, he would give for his life. But put forth thy hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse thee that I say. The Lord said unto Satan, behold, he is in thine hand to save his life. So went Satan forth from the presence of the Lord, and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his feet unto his crown. And he took him a pot shear to scrape himself withal, and he sat down among the ashes. Then said his wife unto him, dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die. But he said unto her, thou speakest one of the foolish women speaketh. What shall we receive good at the hand of God, and we shall not receive evil in this? And this did not Job sin with his lips. You know, right there, the devil tried to turn his own life against you, you know. Curse God and die. Haven't you been through enough? I thought about that song we used to sing. He ain't never done me nothing but good, you know. Job's own wife told him, he said, curse your God and die. But you know what? He didn't, because he had to stay firm. You know, he had to keep on pressing on. He couldn't curse. He couldn't curse the Lord. He told him that he speaks as a foolish woman will speak, you know. You're not going to curse God. It says, right there, it says, and we shall not receive. He said, what good should we receive if we don't receive evil? You know, and there's going to be some hard times, but if you don't go through the hard times, you ain't going to receive nothing good. Before you get saved, you're going through hard times. You know, you're living the life of sin. You know, you're lost. You don't know where to go. But once you go through the hard times, you know, you come and you get saved. You know, that's whenever the good things start to come in. You know, that's whenever the blessings start to come and pour in. You know, once he saved my soul, you know, he saved me. He filled me with the Holy Ghost after, you know. And he called me to preach. It's just the many blessings that he keeps putting on my life. If I keep serving him and I keep pressing on, I can't give up, you know. I got to keep going no matter what. No matter what comes my way, no matter how many times it seems like it's getting too tough to where I can't keep going on. I got to press on, you know. I got to stay committed. I got to keep going. I can't stop. It says, now when Job's three friends heard of all the evil that was come upon him, they came, every one from his own place, Eliphaz the Temanite, and Bildad the Shunite, and Zophar the Naamathite, for they had made an appointment together to come to war with him and to comfort him. And when they lifted up their eyes far off, and they knew him not, they lifted up their voice and wept, and they rent every one his mantle, and sprinkled dust upon their heads towards heaven. So they sat down with him upon the ground 7 days and 7 nights. And none spake a word unto him, for they saw his grief was very great. You know, I thought about right here. I can only imagine what Job is going through. You know, he's lost all his cattle, he's lost all his kids. You know, now his wife turned against him, trying to get him to curse God. You know, but no matter what, it says right there in the end above, in the end of verse 10. You know, no matter what, and all this did not Job sin with his lips. You know. As I said, you know, imagine us putting ourselves in Job's shoes, you know, all this that he has lost, you know, all his family, you know, I can only imagine how bad it'd be to lose one of your kids, you know, what though, he still pressed on, no matter how hard it got, you know, he still pressed on, and it says that the devil smoked him with sore boils. I looked that up and said it's the very grievous disease, you know, it's a disease in your foot, you know, you can't hardly walk or do anything on it, and I thought, you know, how much pain, you know, Job went through, how much loss that he had went through, you know, he was the greatest man of peace, but he lost all that, and I begin to think how easy it would take for us to lose one thing and we didn't give up. All it'd take for us to lose the simplest thing in our life, you know what? We'd say, I'm done. I don't want to keep pressing on.
That's right.
I'm not only speaking to y'all, I'm speaking to myself, you know. I'm up here preaching not to y'all, but I'm preaching to me too. You know, I can't give up just for one little thing that I lose, you know. Say I lose my dog. Say I lose my baseball. Maybe my arm gets broken, I can never play baseball again, you know what? Still got to press on.
That's right.
You know what? My dog dies, a family member dies. Yeah. You know, you grieve when you do this. Yeah, it's earthly. You know, you're going to grieve them, but you still got to press on. No matter what comes your way, you got to press on. You know, I was thinking of, it said that the devil thought that Job, you know, he cared more about his cattle and his family, but yet still he was proved wrong, you know. He took all that, and guess what? Job still was a perfect man. Job still kept on going. Job still stayed committed. He stayed pressing on. You know, I thought about that. You know, the devil said in the commentary that the devil thought that Job mattered, his cattle, his family, all that mattered more than God. But it turns out it didn't. You know, it proved the devil wrong. You know, if the devil took all that from you, yet and still he did not sin out of his mouth. You know?
That's right.
I was thinking of, at our athletic banquet not too long ago, you know, we had a guest speaker. It was some man, I can't remember his name, you know. He was saying a lot. I didn't really get a lot of it, but, you know, I remember one thing. He talked about staying committed.
And no matter what comes your way, it's a stay committed. You know, always. No matter what you're facing, just to stay committed. You know, even if times get hard. Like I said, I've been there in my life before. Whatever seems like things are just falling apart left and right. You know, feel like you can't make it no more. But I'm telling you, if you press on, you receive good things. You know, you're gonna have to go through some hard times. There's gonna be some times in your life whenever you feel like you can't make it. But I'm telling you, if you press on, if you keep going, then that's whenever the good things start to come in. You know, I'm so thankful for all the things that God has put upon my life. It's because I pressed on. It's because I didn't give up whenever times get hard. It's because I keep on going. You know, I stay committed. I want to be just like Job. I want God to send the devil come test my servant Mason. You know, I want him to come, and I want him to try to devour me. But you know what? I want to keep on pressing on. I want to keep on staying committed. You know, I want to be just like Job to the point where he can take everything I've got, and I can be able to press on. You know, I was thinking,
yes,
our phones. You know, how easy would it be if we can't go a day without our phones? You know, I've heard people say you can forget your Bible at the house if you're going on vacation. But you know what? If you forget your phone at home, we got to get back. We could be an hour down the road. We got to get back.
Yeah.
We got to go get our phones. You know, I was thinking, I have my phone everywhere with me, you know. And yet still, I was thinking if it'd be just that simple, just that little thing, our phone, if we took it away, you know, we still praise him. You know, if we lost our phone, you know, we still praise him. You know, I think about how they say you take it everywhere with you. You know, do you take your Bible everywhere with you? Like Angela was saying, you know, do you pray every day? Do you do what you're supposed to do? If you don't, then you're not going to make it. You're not going to be able to press on. You're not going to be able to stay committed.
That's
if you
right.
don't read your Bible every day. If you don't bring your Bible everywhere with you, you know, I sometimes don't do that. You know, I started bringing my Bible to school. I started putting my backpack. You know, I pick it up and I try to read it anytime that I got the chance. But you know, I took it on vacation with me. I took time. I had to get up there. I knew I had to study. You know, I knew we were down there having fun. We had a great time. And I knew I had to take time. I had to wake up and I had to study. But I was thinking about that. What he said at the athletic banquet. You know, just stay committed. Don't give up. Whenever times get tough, don't give up. Keep staying. You know, keep pressing on. But I was thinking about times of my life, you know, whenever I was younger, me and Daddy would be riding on the road, and he'd always make me read my Bible first before I could play the game. You know, I always used to love to play this game called Fortnite. Y'all know I love to play games or whatever. But he'd always make me read my Bible first. You know why? Because he wanted me to stay committed. He wanted me to live. He wanted me to do a certain way. He wanted me to put God first. And that's how you got to live if you're going to press on. You got to put God first. You got to read your Bible. You got to do what he wants you to do. And I thought about all the examples on my life. You know, I looked up to Brother Brown and Sister Brown. You know, I was young, but I still remember things about them. I still remember the way that man lived. I still remember the way that man preached. You know, I was young, but I remember him getting up here, and I remember him preaching. You know, and I look at Uncle Russell, he looked, he's just like him. You know, I got all these examples in my life. I can think back to Mama Pierce, you know. I had her example all my life. I can think of Amy, you know, the Christian lady she is, Mama. And, you know, I got all these examples in my life that show me whenever times get tough, you can't give up. You got to keep pressing on. Every time it's tough, you can't give up. You gotta make sure that you're doing everything that you can to stay committed to press home, you know. Like I said, I was thinking about all of the examples, you know. I think about the way Brother Brown lives. I think about the way Uncle Russell lives, you know, the way Aunt Shell lives. They're all examples upon my life, you know, that I can live by. I can see, I can watch them as they do stuff, you know. Whenever times get tough, they didn't give up. If they not, they wouldn't be where they are today. If times didn't get tough and if I gave up, I wouldn't be where I am today. I wouldn't be behind this pulpit. I wouldn't be able to be here to preach the word if I wouldn't have gave up. You know, Aunt Lynn's talking about she's for sure, you know, I'm for sure too, that they've gone on to heaven because of the way they live. And all my parents, I'm pretty sure, I'm sure, you know, that she went to heaven because I see the way she lived. I see the way she dressed. I see the way she acted, the way she talked. You know, she lived as God would want her to. She pressed on. She stayed committed. Whenever times get tough, I look at Brother Brown and Sister Brown, you know, that I believe all assurance that they went to heaven because of the way they lived. Because they pressed on whenever times get tough, you know. Y'all stand there, y'all speak. I've watched all these examples in my life. Is whenever times get tough, you know, they didn't give up. If they didn't, they wouldn't be the man that they are today. Matthew, James, you know, all of them. If they didn't give up, whenever times get tough, you know, you feel like you can't make it no more. If you just give up, you're not going to make it nowhere. You're not going to get no good things. out of what God has in store for you. You know, he's never done with somebody, you know. And there's so many more things he's got set up all my life, and I'm so ready for it. I'm so ready to get all the many blessings that he has for me. But, you know, he's got something on each and every one of y'all's life in here. He's not done working with y'all. He'll never be done working with y'all. Y'all can't never get too much of God. He can't never, you know, I want to make sure my cup is full. I want to make sure that it is running over. You know, I can never get enough of God. I got to make sure that I'm good and I'm ready to stay committed whenever times get tough, to stay to press on. I just want to make sure, you know, if anybody, if times get tough, you know, don't give up. I'm telling you, that'd be your worst mistake, is to give up. There's been times in my life that I gave up, but you know what? I had the Lord to help me. You know, he sent that comforter down to, sent that comforter down to strengthen us. He sent that comforter down to be able for us to press on, you know. And I'm glad that through the hard times, you know, that I pressed on and I didn't give up. Because like I said, I wouldn't be where I am today. I'm so thankful that I pressed on. I'm so thankful that I stayed committed. I'm going to stay committed. I'm going to stay pressing on. And anybody that wants to, y'all can come back here and y'all can pray.